From the Australian National University College of Law, this is Law and Crisis, bringing you interdisciplinary perspectives on the questions we're confronting today that will shape our future. In this episode, we explore inequality and epidemiology with ANU public health researcher, Professor Emily Banks.
I'm very pleased today to be joined by one of Australia's leading experts in public health, Professor Emily Banks, who's Professor of Epidemiology and Public Health here at the ANU and is part of NSEF. And I know that both Emily and NSEF more generally have been key advisors on government policy throughout this whole process that's been emerging. So it's like that joke about bankruptcy, Emily. How did you go bankrupt? First slowly and then very, very quickly. And that's exactly what we've been experiencing here. But while I'm mentioning jokes, I did read in a newspaper the other day, some famous epidemiologist from the UK, I think, who said that what pandemic experts say amongst themselves is, seen one epidemic, seen one epidemic. So is that a fair statement of things, or are there generalities? Are there things that we can learn from prior experience?
Well, Desmond, as you know, all generalizations are bad. So it's very important to remember, first of all, that there are things that are common between epidemics, and then there are things that are very different. So I think it is true to say that some of our kind of some of the issues that have happened in dealing with COVID have related to where people have generalized from, say, flu to COVID, and some of the things that have gone right have been the things that we have learned from other epidemics, but also things that we have learned that are specific to COVID. Now, I think we should really preface all of this to say that in Australia, we have been immensely fortunate, and there are, I think, many different reasons for that. The first is that we saw what had happened in a number of different countries and we learnt from it. We also are more closely connected to Asia. So I think we were in a position to learn a lot more from the countries which had effectively controlled the epidemic in Asia. The other thing is, I think that our community was to some strange extent primed by the bushfires. So by going through the bushfires, the community really recognised that we needed to act together and that we needed to trust people who had expertise and on-the-ground skills in guiding us through a terrible crisis. And so we were very quick to react, and we had extremely high levels of adherence to social distancing. The latest assessments are that we had around 80% or more adherence to social distancing. And so it really, I think, brings home what we as public health people know, which is the communities control pandemics.
Presumably, I mean, the problems and the responses have had to be extremely different in developing countries, for example, without the kind of level of perhaps social cohesion, but perhaps also infrastructure and social infrastructure that Australia has.
Yes, I mean, each country has had to really contend with whatever its main constraints are. And I have to say that some of the constraints, they're not confined to developing countries. I mean, we've had fantastic responses and outcomes, for example, in Vietnam. And Sri Lanka has done incredibly well. So there are examples of places that have been able to use their resources really very effectively. And then if we look at the situation in the US, it's not really a matter of purely material circumstances that mean whether people can react cohesively and effectively as a society to a pandemic. A lot of it relates to levels of understanding, but also levels of trust and ability to actually act together and cohesively as a community. And I think people look at Australia and they look at the US and they think, well, post-colonial and a whole lot of similarities. But actually what I think you can also see is that the level of adherence to what was required for this pandemic has actually been really quite different in different places. Having said that, in the US, there are a lot of other circumstances that influence their response. And you can also see that a number of states fared better than other states. And so I think there are, you know, a huge number of learnings that we can have from this. The other thing is that pretty much all of the countries have managed to what we would call flatten the curve in one way or another. So if you look at a lot of those graphs, even places that have been really profoundly affected, like Italy, France, Spain, UK and US, they're all showing that flattening, which has come from the community really doing effective social distancing, as well as all the other measures.
I mean, I find that very interesting, your point to connect this back to the bushfires and to think that this was a kind of a primer in social trust, right, in building communities, as you said, and taking community responsibility, and also how we pay attention to expertise, what we expect of governments and so forth. And I think that, you know, to me, that's a compelling argument. But it makes me think about, you know, what's in the news in the last day or so has been the tracking app. And obviously, this is raising various questions about the levels of trust, that how far we're prepared to go in terms of that trust. How important do you think that the app is in as we move forward, moving more into a track and trace kind of model in over the next few weeks or months? Is it your view that this is key, that we have to do this? Can you see where people are coming from with this kind of skepticism about where this is going and where it might lead to?
So the first thing to say is we're actually going to have to be very engaged as a community in the next phase, because as I said, communities control pandemics and the community has taken us to this point. We're not actually at the point where all of the fire is extinguished. If we're going to continue with that analogy, we've still got spot fires in various places. We've still got some active blazes. But the other thing is, we need a system that lets us know when things are flared up again, if they flare up. And the other thing is that we will still be getting embers coming in from other places where there are still, you know, fires raging. So we have to have a system in place. And that system will include really, really good detection or early detection of cases. And that will largely be coming from people who've got symptoms needing to be checked out to check that they don't have COVID. And that combined with really, really good contact tracing, both what we call upstream, which is to look at where that person, any case might have gotten their disease from, but also downstream to make sure that we isolate the people who are contacts. So that's a framework, that's a system. And that system and the community enacting that system is what will help us through the next phase. We're also going to have to do other kinds of testing in the groups we consider to be vulnerable or sort of sentinel groups, so things like healthcare workers and aged care. So it is going to be a kind of package, and the community will have to engage with it. Now, thinking about that package, it will be helpful if people do engage with the app. And I think it will help put Australia in an even better position. But that app does have to be fit for purpose, and people do have to be able to trust it. So I can understand people being cautious about what details they give and where their details are going. And I think people need to be reassured, and there needs to be really good tight security about what's going to happen to that. I also think that we need to be very clear that with people about the importance of this. And that it is really, really critical to our ongoing well-being, because the better we can make that surveillance system or early detection system, the more freedom we can have. So if we know we've got a really good system to detect any very early spot fires and we've got systems to damp down those embers coming in, then we can actually relax a lot of our social distancing. So I think it's also that balance that people have to understand. If they have an app that they can trust and they are able to engage with the overall system, then actually the reward for Australia will be that we'll have a better system for control of COVID, and we'll be able to return to a lot of the levels of social and economic engagement that we were able to do before. We may still have limits on what we would call potential super spreading events, which are things like, huge gatherings, but we may be able to actually return to a lot of the other activities. And I think the other thing is, which is, it's a point that's not really considered widely, but I think it will become increasingly important, is that if Australia does manage to get to the stage where there's no community transmission that's discernible, incredibly low levels or none, we actually will have a lot of opportunities that other countries and other jurisdictions don't have. We'll be able to, you know, people will feel much better sending their young ones here to study. They might think differently about Australian products. We might be able to engage in closer bilateral relationships with other countries that have eliminated the virus. So I think that the question about the app needs, first of all, to be framed in terms of the app does need to be appropriately secure, and people too need to be able to trust it. I think people also need to understand that there will be really good benefits with them engaging with the system as a whole, and the app will help with that.
Right, and so part of that is about law. It's about how you frame and how you securitize the system and how you assure people that those processes are robust, that they'll stay in place, that they're not going to be backdoored, right, that there aren't going to be, you know, all these other things that are going on. And people, I think, are rightly concerned about that because we do have a record of things like that happening in the past that people need to be, you know, that have made people skeptical of these kinds of things. But then you're also saying there's a communication question here, which is about what the benefits are, why we're doing these things and what might be the upside, right, in the long run. I mean, I guess that what I wonder is to what extent are we dealing with a situation which is all or nothing? Or to what extent can we choose, you know, like is a bit of a pie better than no pie at all? Or do we have to go the whole pie or it's not worth it? Because, you know, when I look at law as a discourse, it's all about balancing risk. It's never about absolutes, right? It's all about the laws of the road are not designed to ensure that there are no deaths on the road, right? They are very much about balancing, and we accept certain costs of those balancing. Now we're faced with a situation, and sometimes it seems like the argument that's being presented is an absolutist one. And so I guess I'm just asking you, is that true, or are there ways of balancing or creating degrees that will be better than nothing but will not necessarily be absolute?
Well, I think public health is all about balance as well. And I think it's an illusion, the idea that it's absolutist. I mean, if you really, really wanted to immediately control the epidemic, you'd basically lock everyone in their houses and not let them out.
Right.
I mean, so we have always been balancing, and whatever we do, we are to some extent balancing things. The fact that people can still go outside, they can still go for a walk, they can still see one other person, they can still, you know, those sorts of things. While they don't seem like large things, they are actually balancing things because they are not the absolute lowest risk outcome. And they're not the lowest risk actions at all. And whatever we're doing, and in public health has a probability distribution related to it. So public health is very good friends with almost every discipline. We're not choosy about where our insights come from. We use the law quite a lot in, you know, you only have to look at things like tobacco control, infectious disease and control.
Yeah.
But we're very good friends with statistics and epidemiology. And those are related to probability. So you can imagine we have brought this epidemic under control as a community in a large extent because we have more than 80% adherence to the social distancing measures by the Australian population. Now, that's not 100%, that's 80%. And, you know, you can bring the epidemic under control quicker by having more draconian measures, but that's not how we operate. So you're absolutely right. But what we're talking about is a framework that says we will catch all of the transmission chains of COVID going forward under these different systems. So one of the things I think your listeners might be interested in is that when we think about infectious diseases, we're really talking about diseases that occur in chains. They're all linked to one, you know, the cases don't occur in isolation. So when we're actually testing for those for COVID-19, we're looking to detect those chains. And then what we do is we use contact tracing to find all the different cases in the chains and also to manage contacts. So when it comes to detecting those chains, first of all, we need people with symptoms to come forward and be tested. But we also need those people to be able to tell us where they've been and who they've seen so that we can actually protect those people and protect the people they've been close to.
Yeah, I mean, I think what you're saying about the interdisciplinary nature of public health is a really great point, well made. So I wonder whether you would agree with me, and perhaps you wouldn't agree with me, if I said that one of the things I think about is it seems to me that something like law and something like public health and indeed something like economics have different normative bottom lines, and that one of the issues here is that we're faced with a kind of a clash of normative bottom lines, and it's difficult to know how to deal with that. They seem to be incommensurable. And to make it very crudely, if we think of a normative bottom line of public health as being save lives, and a normative bottom line of the economy as being maximize utility, let's say, and then the normative bottom line as law as being something like constrain power, those seem to be very different vocabularies of understanding, you know, what is the ineradicable fundamental principle that we can't go past. And the one of the issues here is that we're faced with a difficulty of communicating between those different normative fundamentals.
Well, Desmond, I think I'm a bit more optimistic than you, because I think that the aims of all three of those disciplines is to make things better for our community. And I also think that often those three disciplines have very similar, once you've worked out that is your goal, actually they have very similar interests in those goals and not dissimilar outcomes. So although economists might disagree with various things, and I think if you get three economists in the room, they won't all agree with each other. But in general, the outcomes that are best for public health are also best for the economy. And what we've seen with COVID, in fact, is that those countries which have a lesser epidemic are also going to have better outcomes economically. And you can imagine the scenario where we get to very, very low numbers in Australia. Actually, we'll be permitted to have greater levels of social and economic activity, and that'll be better economically. And in fact, there's quite a lot of evidence that shows that had we not shut down our economic and social activity to the extent we did, the COVID would have ripped through our society. We would have actually had worse economic outcomes than during the shutdown. The thing about the shutdown is it's an active shutting down. We've actually made a political decision to do it. The other one's more of an act of omission rather than commission. I do think that there are differences, and between the bottom lines for public health and the bottom lines for law. Public health really takes a sort of systems view of outcomes. It doesn't seek to blame individuals, and it is actually in many ways very non-judgmental about that. So public health will tend to talk about things like, needle exchange, supervised injecting rooms, condoms in prisons. Public health assumes that if you put a whole lot of people together under certain circumstances, they will act in a certain way. So I think it's very interesting to look at things like the Abu Ghraib atrocities in Iraq, where the law would say, well, those were bad people who should be punished for torturing these prisoners. And the public health point of view might be more like, if you put people who are poorly trained in a situation where actually there's an atmosphere that sort of stuff is not only ignored, it's sort of condoned in some ways, then you will get those sorts of outcomes. So I think there is a clash at that point that public health does not, it looks at the behaviour of populations. It considers the individuals within those populations, but it does not it doesn't think about an individual moral failure bringing about disease or bad outcomes. Now, I can understand that. I'm a public health physician partly because I believe in that. But I also think that law has an important role to play in these things. And there are plenty of examples where some of our most brilliant public health triumphs have been in partnership with law. I think we can be proud of that. I think the other thing that this pandemic has made clear is actually the power that the legal power that public health has. So most people are not aware of the powers of the chief medical officer or the chief health officers within each state. But this kind of occasion really makes people aware of those, the power to close borders, the power to mandate certain activities. And they've also been doing things like stepping in when there's kind of dodgy testing kits and things like that. So I'd get back to your original point. I don't think that economics and law and public health are really that different in their fundamental aims. I think that there are some differences in approaches, but I think they're often more reconcilable than they seem.
Okay, well, I think that's interesting. What you were saying about the judgmental perspective of law. I mean, I think you're right about that. I always say law is really good at melodrama and it's terrible at tragedy, because it can't deal with systems and it can't deal with where you don't have a... If law sees a villain, it knows what to do. But if there's no villain to be seen, it's really at a bit of a loss for words. And I think that, you know, that reflects some of what you were saying. I think kind of as a final kind of question, and maybe we're going too far out of our remit on this, I mean, I think the thing that really worries me is... To put it one way, it's about politics. To put it another way, it's about the long-term public health outcomes of what's happened, which is that if we look, let's say, a year down the track, then we are looking at a kind of a long-term catastrophe with millions of more people who are unemployed, hundreds of millions of people driven into poverty, massive amounts of starvation in countries all around the world. And I worry a lot about that. And what I worry about is that the people who will suffer from that, not now, but in a year's time and in 10 years' time, will be the usual suspects. And that this has been one of those crises that has driven processes of inequality, let us say, which have already been, you know, pretty powerful in the world today. But far from reining those in, we've kind of given them a bit of a turbo boost. And that's what worries me about those long-term kind of problems that the decisions that we're making now are setting in train.
I think you're absolutely right to be concerned. I think there will be knock-on effects of this. I think that it's very clear that letting the virus just rip through doesn't fix that. It actually may, to my mind, it would make that worse. But I think it does mean that we have to think about taking active steps as a global community and as a country to mitigate those effects. Because, you know, as a public health person, the biggest cause of ill health relates to those inequalities. We would have 20,000 fewer deaths every single year in Australia if the least well off in our society had the same death rates as the most well off. So it's a very big contributor. And we need to think, I think, very, very carefully about that.
And so the challenge really is, where and how do you have those conversations, right? How do you put these kinds of questions front and center, rather than simply reifying them into the results of a disease, right? The saying, you know, the virus has done this. The virus has caused 150 million to be in poverty, right? It's like saying starvation is just a fact of whatever, life in Africa or something like that. These things are socially constructed, and they are things that we need to take political and social responsibility for.
Yes, and I do think that the virus has united us and has actually connected us a lot more to our global communities. So, you know, I'm spending quite a bit of time talking to people in Italy, the UK. I'm via a lot of media with what people are going through in different places. And I think a lot of us are thinking, well, what can I do? What can I do as an individual? How can I help to support other people, other places? So I think one of the most important things is to have these conversations and to connect them with practical action about what we can do.
Thanks, Emily. It's been a great conversation. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Desmond.
Law in Crisis is produced by the ANU College of Law. If you're interested in navigating the challenges of this uncertain time, we offer a range of postgraduate degree programs taught by interdisciplinary experts. Start your journey today at law.anu.edu.au.